Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. It's so good to see you all here today, and some of you I've seen and met, and so I'm glad you're here. I think that we're in for a very interesting, provocative discussion. As you know, we're going to be talking about through the lens of color, black representation in film. And today, with so much talk about movies like Black Panther, Moonlight, Creed, and others, and a whole lineup, not long enough, but a number of African-American filmmakers coming on the scene. And we're going to be talking today about images in traditional mainstream movies, and then what African-American filmmakers have done to tell their own stories. And in some ways, it is a story of struggle, and it's a story of triumph. And I've got three terrific people here with me. And the first person is the author of a book called Migrating to Movies. And it's a stunning piece of scholarship. And it's a real social, cultural, important document. And it's also a great read. And the author of this book also co-curated a fantastic five-disc set of films made outside of the Hollywood studio system, where you can get to see this work by African Americans. And she's really a terrific voice. And I'd like you to welcome her. She is professor of cinema and media studies at the University of Chicago. And here she is, Jacqueline Stewart. Jacqueline on TCN because she was talking about some of these films when that set first appeared, and it is terrific.
Thank you.
It really is. And then we have, I think I have it in the right order. He's really something. he started off as an actor, and he is the son of a legendary filmmaker. And he followed eventually in his father's footsteps and stopped acting. He had been in he still does act, but he was in a TV series called Sunny Spoon. I don't know if any of you have seen it. You probably can find it somewhere. It's still interesting to see. And he began to write and direct his own films. If you ever see New Jack City from 1991. And he also directed the movie Posse and the movie Panther, which his father wrote, and his father's right back there, the great Melvin Fever. And he changed the direction of movies in the 70s. And we're going to talk about that legendary film. And I'd like you to welcome him. He also made a movie about the making of Sweetback called Badass. So would you give a hand for Mario Van Peebles?
Thank you.
Our third panelist is a man who's an entertainment journalist. He's much more, he's a strong political consciousness as well. And he co-founded the African American Film Critics Association. His articles have appeared in so many publications, things as diverse as the LA Times, Billboard, Fortune, Essence and Ebony. And he's been covering the scene for some time and has noted these changes and developments in movies with African Americans, as well as the film scene itself. And I'd like you to welcome Gil Robertson. Now, to be quite frank with you, we have a lot we do want to talk about. And we do want to talk about the current scenes, but we do note that nothing really happens in a historical vacuum. And this whole issue of images of African Americans in Hollywood films or mainstream films, and criticism coming from the African American community about those images, this goes way back. And something else goes way back, and that is African American filmmakers in love with film and determined to tell their own stories from their own points of view and giving us these incredible visions that are so totally distinct and so totally theirs. Now, with that in mind, we want to note when we go back to the early years of the century, 20th century, way back then, there was a film that appeared that we have to mention that was it was a feature film. It told a story that audiences found compelling, and it dealt with a very distorted way with the topic of race. And this movie, of course, was D.W. Griffith's 1915 classic racist masterwork, if we can call it that. And this film, when it came out, it's very interesting. There was a real response to it. And early on, people realized the power of the filmic image and the ways it could be used as propaganda against black people. And I just want to ask Jacqueline, can you tell us something about the response of Birth of a Nation? Because so much of it goes back to that.
Sure. Well, I mean, there were a handful of filmmakers working before The Birth of a Nation, but that was a film that really catapulted and catalyzed these filmmakers to figure out, as you were saying, how they could use this medium that could sway the minds of so many people. I mean, there was a rise in the membership of the Ku Klux Klan as a result of The Birth of a Nation, because, of course, the Klan rides the rescue at the end of the film. And so one of the most important figures to think about in relationship to early black filmmaking in this regard is Oscar Michaud, who was a filmmaker who started doing work in 1918 and made over 40 films over the next 30 years. But in those silent early days, he was heavily invested in figuring out how to respond to the kinds of racist images that were being created in mainstream Hollywood films. So he has a remarkable film called Within Our Gates, from 1920.
Mm-hmm. That is. Have you seen it?
It's on the Pioneers of African American Cinema box set, which you should all have. I'm not trying to sell it, really, it's a historical necessity. I really don't think that you're a responsible film historian teaching this history if you don't teach Within Our Gates alongside the explanation, which I always try to do. It's a film that answers it point for point, so that while The Birth of a Nation sort of unites the white North and the white South in this kind of racist ideology, Michaud gives us the black North and the black South coming together to figure out how they can join in a really powerful, emotional, and politically charged way. So Michaud was a true pioneer, someone who recognized that his films could never be authorized by people who were in the dominant industry. And in fact, his film suffered a tremendous amount of censorship. And so from city to city, which is how censorship was handled during that period, he would add scenes back to his films. He was determined to get this message across and to figure out ways that he could use the power of cinema to galvanize a kind of anti-racist response.
And Within Our Gates was lost to us for a while.
It was, yes. It was in an archive in Spain. under the title La Negra for decades, until Thomas Cripps, really important historian of African-American cinema, thought, wait a minute, I think I know who some of these actors are. That question of repatriating films, of discovering films that are only about half of Michaud's films seem to survive. But I'm sure there are more far-flung that we'll continue to discover.
Well, one thing with a filmmaker like Michaud and other films that were being made, not necessarily by African-American filmmakers, but being made during the silent period and so forth, there is a real, what becomes a problem for some of them. It's a real technological change that comes about in the industry in the late 1920s, 1927 to be exact. Can you talk to us about that and what it did?
The coming of sound made filmmaking much more expensive. It also was a problem in terms of film exhibition. So during the period that we're talking about, film going was segregated. So we'd have the white people maybe on one side of an aisle in a southern small theater, and the black people on the other side, or in the balcony, or separate theaters altogether in larger cities. So to maintain an independent black cinematic culture was really difficult, not just for filmmakers, but also for film exhibitors in black neighborhoods. Michaud was remarkable in many ways, one of which is that he survived that transition from silent to sound filmmaking. He started getting funding, actually, from white backers during that period in order to continue his film practice. But it's important to think about some of the other filmmakers who began to emerge during the sound era. Spencer Williams is one of the most important figures to talk about in this part of that history.
Yes.
I'm finishing a book on Spencer Williams, actually. There hasn't been a book dedicated to him. And he made a remarkable film called The Blood of Jesus, 1941, shot in Texas, in and around Dallas and San Antonio.
So and you using locals.
Using local
as well.
People, locations,
yes.
Churches. There's this beautiful, we were talking yesterday when watching Sweet Sweetback about the credit that says starring the black community.
Yes.
Race movies star the black community. And that's certainly true of Spencer Williams' work. Many of you might know Spencer Williams from playing Andy on the Amos and Andy television show. But for decades before that, he was an independent black filmmaker.
Another thing about Spencer Williams that's interesting, there were black westerns in the 1930s starring Herb Jeffries. I don't know if you're familiar with Herb Jeffries, but he was terrific. I'll tell you something about him. I interviewed him a couple times, and when I first interviewed him, I mean, he was a real character, quite striking. He let me know he was a senior citizen, and he had a 35-year-old wife who was devoted to him. The next time I went to interview him, he was past senior citizen age, and he had a new wife who was also devoted, and I think he lived to be about 101. But Mario, with some of his westerns, and Spencer Williams is in them and wrote for them, did they influence you with your movie Posse?
Yeah, of course they did. I saw a lot of the early westerns. I saw Bronze Buckaroo because of Brother Babu, who I would acknowledge here from the Black Filmmaker Foundation. He got me on the phone with Jeffries, and when I did Posse, you'll see some of the Bronze Buckaroos and the westerns at the end of credits, and also. Of course, Woody Strode.
Yes.
Woody Strode. Yeah. So what I wanted to do with Posse, and we can talk about that later, but was to show that we can understand how we profit and stand on the shoulders of giants. So I wanted Woody Strode to be the Posse from the 50s. My dad, Mr. Cook from Smooka Sat by the Door, Isaac Hayes, Pam Grier, they were the Posse of the 70s in Posse.
Yeah.
And then me and Daddy Kane and all the rest of you, were, the Posse of the 90s. So that you saw generationally that process, and so we went back to Woody Strode. In fact, Woody, when he read the script, said he didn't want to do any more westerns. And I said, sir, this western's a little different. this goes back to what your question was. I said, please just read a little bit of it and call me back. He read a little bit, he read five pages, he called me back, he said, they gonna let you say this? Because I took sort of a Dick Gregory thing where Dick says that history's a funny thing. They got me believing Columbus discovered America, but we know the Native Americans were already here, so that's like me discovering your Cadillac and putting my flag on it and saying you're evil red savage if you don't get out the Cadillac quick enough. So when he read that, he said, are they gonna let you say this, son? I said, sir, in this particular case, I am the they. We put Ron's Buckaroo, we put the Herb Jeffries flick in the end, and I called up the brother from Paramount. They said I'd never get it, and I got the last clip of Woody Strode, and that wound up being Woody's last speaking role. Mm. It was Bossy.
Yeah. I love those historical connections.
Yeah, man. And when you plug it all in, you see the power of it.
Yeah, exactly.
We get separated from that head from the body, then we're weak.
You know, one thing, Jacqueline, you had mentioned The Blood of Jesus, which I think is 1941.
41, that's
right. Yeah. Which comes out, and it's interesting with just mainstream cinema and the effects of World War II, and with the black press, and the Negro press has been very important. I come from a family of the black press, so I'm always stressing it as much as I can. But there were these concerns about these images, I mean, being expressed in a new way. And then there were protests against certain Hollywood films, Tales of Manhattan, the movie that Paul Robeson and Ethel Waters had done in the early 40s. And what happens after the war, when black GIs are returning home after having fought abroad for the freedom of others, and coming home and discovering basic rights that they didn't have. And we're really at the dawn of the civil rights movement. And Hollywood, some filmmakers, begin to see that there have to be different images of African Americans. Because one thing we should note, and this is not criticism of the actors, but African Americans, these images that were there coming from Hollywood, they often were comic servants. They were singers, dancers, extraordinarily exceptional talents. But there was nothing that Hollywood was doing that was trying to look at the system, trying to look at African-American life and culture. And then this does shift in 1949. And we showed a film here yesterday called Intruder in the Dust. And It was based on a novel by Faulkner, and it starred one of these great black actors who was sort of unacknowledged today. His picture's right over there in the hat. Juana Hernandez, who was actually born in Puerto Rico. But there were four films, Pinky, Lost Boundaries, Home of the Brave, Intruder in the Dust, that sets the pace for Sidney Poitier. And this is a whole new image in the movies. It doesn't quite set the pace for Dorothy Dandridge, but Dandridge gets in there. And people don't realize that she was the one in the beginning, before Poitier, she really changed it. She had such power, if you see her in Carmen Jones, and it's really about a woman making a decision. If you see Spike Lee's movie, She's Gotta Have It, later, Dandridge does this earlier, where she is not gonna be controlled by men. But nonetheless, Poitier comes in, and we have the Poitier image in the 50s and the 60s. And he is lauded, which he should be as an actor, but there were other things happening in those movies. What do you think, Gil?
Well, you know, the early work that Sidney Poitier, it's kind of hard to talk about Sidney Poitier's early work without also talking about his collaborations with Stanley Kramer, who did some of his most important projects, you know, like the Defiant Ones. But Sidney really did signal his very presence, the types of roles that he was playing, of a dignified, you know, black man, was something that previous to that you really didn't see, you know, on screen. And so the intelligent black man, the respectable black man, you know, he embodied all of those things that society necessarily told us didn't exist. And so seeing that image was very powerful and certainly, you know, was revolutionary in a way. you know, and obviously opened the door for, you know, the work that Mario's dad was able to do, as well as Gordon Parks, Harry Belafonte, Rod Peters, on and on.
Well, there's one thing about the Poitier image, that at times there's a mix there. I mean, we're moving forward, or Hollywood is, and there are those steps back. I mean, the defiant ones, which he has these powerful moments, but there's a climax of that film where he comes off the train to save his friend Tony Curtis. Now, James Baldwin said when he saw The Defiant Ones with a black audience in Harlem, he said that when Sidney Poitier came off the train to save Tony Curtis, the black audience said, "Get back on that train, fool. That you have a chance at freedom." So there's a mix there. I mention this because Poitier himself, he came in for criticism in the late 60s. As a matter of fact, a black writer named Clifford Mason wrote an article in the Arts and Leisure section of the New York Times where, and I think the title of it was something, "Why White Folks Love Sidney So Much," that he later changes his image and begins to direct and understands who's telling the story and what haven't they told us before. And he's answering other questions. But Poitier is jolted in the 70s, as the 70s are started, because there's an outsider, an independent filmmaker who really turns movie history for a large audience on its head. Mary, can you guess who that filmmaker is?
Yeah, I think it's that brother right there. So, but I think the I think that there's
everybody always picking on you.
Just as a side note, my dad did a movie you should check out called Classified X, where it tracks, it's dope, it tracks, it's a documentary on all on a lot of black cinema from the early days, and it goes from, you know, Birth of a Nation on up, the servant class, and what we call in my family, Motisa class, which is Motisa. You remember Posse. And it goes up to black folks pre-Civil War, and then we need folks to get, World War II, and then, there's a disruptor back there. But it goes on up. So what I think is interesting with, you know, how I saw the Poitier phenomenon was that, and I said something about this last night, was that, you know, we had the experience of being colored. And what's interesting about a name is colored implied that we were just, you know, slightly different from white folks. You know, you got white folks and we're colored. So we just, come on, man. So what that implies is recognize our humanity. Let us have a little slice of the pie. And brother Malcolm is saying, look, I enjoy Dr. King. I don't understand the cat because I know he's doing this nonviolent thing that Gandhi did, but that was a big brown elephant sitting on the British colonizers, which was a little white elephant. This is different because they've been whipping our butts for 400 years and they're just getting better at it. So he said, I would like them to listen to Dr. King, but I'm the alternative. So when Brother Malcolm says, peace, freedom by any means, Dr. King says, freedom by peaceful means, and they kill them both, I think you have sort of the collapse of that colored movement and the beginning, the birth of black folks getting pissed off and the birth of the Black Panther movement. And so that is then represented by Sweetback on the screen in the big
way. Can you tell us something about Sweetback? I mean, the image and also your father's, I mean, he is a hero for the independent movement.
Well,
how he got this film made.
Think about Poitier for a second. Black men up until then weren't even supposed to have facial hair in the movie. That was considered too far out. You've seen my film Badass is on the making of it because it was such an incredible time in my life. Like I said, I didn't understand the war, but I had an inkling of what the battle was sometimes. My dad comes in and plays a street hustler that goes from a me mentality to a we mentality. And that's, I think, why the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense embraced it, was that they loved that he embraced going up against the system, that we understood that, as Paul Robeson said, when you buy into the paradigm or the zeitgeist, the values of a people that would buy and sell you, what have you become?
Yes.
What's dope about Sweetback is Sweetback made being a revolutionary hip, going up against the man hip. That's what the Panthers love. Later, when they had a script written by Ernest Heidelman about a private detective, they saw my dad make all that money, and they said, you know, Hollywood's not just white and black, it's also green. They said, let's put in the same thing, an empowered black guy with a mustache in the lead and get a dope soundtrack. Melvin had Earth, Wind, and Fire. Let's get this young brother from Stax, call Isaac Hayes, and call the movie Shaft. But what the Panthers astutely pointed out was where Sweetback made being a revolutionary hit, Shaft made working for the man hit, because he was a private detective working with the cops. And Superfly takes it a step further and makes dealing drugs for the man hit. And that's really crippling. So what happens is they're imitating now the studios or the corporations are imitating the icing, but they're taking out the revolutionary core of that cake. And we're still nodding. We were in Sweetback, you're nodding about they bled my mama, they bled my papa, they won't bleed me, which is a statement up against the system. Whereas in Superfly, you're now, I'm your mama, I'm your daddy. So you're nodding your head, which is you're scoring your life with a song that's about glamorizing a drug dealer. Yeah. Cool as hell. But you gotta look at the impact of it. And so rap again starts out that same way with saying the revolution will be televised, and Melvin Van Peebles doing this thing, and Gil Scott Heron. But eventually they even with NWA said you'd rather see me in a pen than me and Lorenzo rolling in a Benzo. But the corporation, when they invest in it, they'll say, no, we're gonna make it about bitches and hoes and gin and juice, and take out the revolutionary core. Yeah. And that's the difference between independent and dependent, is that independent, you can make the vision, and dependent, you gotta sort of sign on to that other vision. And that's that tricky line.
Well, the other thing that happened, I wanna say something about, one thing that happens, I mean, when we get to what is known as the Blaxploitation period, mm-hmm. where all of this resistance and even the anger or frustration, it's turned into a formula for films. And what you're saying, even taking the revolutionary aspect out, the Blaxploitation comes in, and those films end up really helping the film industry, helping to save it. I mean, there's a story about Shaft, which was an MGM film.
It sold off their back lot, got rid of Garth and Sydney's. They
because
were in paper.
MGM, you know, this great studio, it was reported to be near bankruptcy at that point, and Shaft made a lot of money, and Isaac Hayes got an Oscar for his music. But I did want to go back to Sweet Sweet Bad's song, Something. Gil, do you remember when you first saw it and your response to it?
Oh, wow, I was a kid. You know, and I remember when the movie, but kind of remember when the movie came out. There was a lot of talk, you know, in the household about this film, and so you knew it was important. But because of some of the elements, you know, at that time I couldn't. But remember,
why you gotta talk about my scene?
But you know, it was one of those movies that you had a lot of anticipation for when you would get the opportunity to watch it. And when I did watch it for the first time, I was just really blown away. And understanding the story of how Mr. Van Peebles, you know, was able to, you know, elevate his vision, you know, to the big screen in such an independent way is, you know, just earned me, you know, endless admiration for, you know, for who he is as a creator.
Mm-hmm. And the other interesting thing about all of this, that you have all of that activity going on in Hollywood with these, and often they were low budget films being made, and there was an audience that was so hungry. And Sweetback was the one, it just opened it all up. But something that I'm interested in, because this is a thing that has, it's plagued independence. And it's how an independent filmmaker, like your father, Mario, how he gets it made, and then when it's done, how does he get people into theaters to see it? And Oscar Michaud had this, that he was a showman, and he wanted his movie seen. But your father, for this period, can you tell us some of the things that he did?
Well, he's a brilliant marketer. But I have to also say, and I'll talk about that in a second, but I also want to recognize that, you know, if you make a hit movie that makes $15 million when it's a dollar a ticket, now that's a $12 a ticket today, that's what, $150 to $170 million? If you make that kind of hit, you get invited back to Hollywood. But they were so pissed that Melvin had done it his vision, his way, broke the unions, put women on the crew, black folks and hippies and everybody, all of us together, that what I saw as a kid growing up wasn't just what was in front of the camera, but the beautiful reflection of the world and of all of us Americans on behind the camera. That was true power, and that was a real threat to Hollywood. So I asked my dad once, I said, Pop, why do you think you didn't get another shot? He says, son, if you go into a pool hall, and the pool hall's called Hollywood, and you pretend you don't know pool, and you hustle them, and you get them to bet, and then you run the table, you can't go back again. Yeah? So I have to say much up to Melvin, because he took a bullet going in that pool hall and whooping some ass. You know. But the way he did it was, and this is something that they imitated afterwards, and this is not unusual. You know, you look at, we black folks have often gone first. You have our movement, then the women's movement, the gay movement. We tend to lead. And what he did was, he understood that we're an auditory culture. His very hot secretary, who I had a crush on, wanted to act in the movie. He wanted her to act in the movie, but she had a jealous boyfriend that wasn't having it. But he had a new band, and he loved my dad. He said, you can't act with my girl, but I'm going to do your music, and my band's called Earth, Wind, and Fire. So they did the music. So what he did was, as folks that listen in a different way, he said, let me go to radio. So he takes the soundtrack for Sweetback and goes on to radio. And then he just invites the system to weigh in. And the system, the ratings board was all white. So he comes out with a t-shirt saying, you know, rated X by an all-white jury. And that was the coolest thing, though, man. I'm watching this cat. I'm 13, watching this dude. Wow, if I could do this. He does some stuff. So there was a guy from, I think, the New York Times that wrote about the movie. And he, nice guy, he said, big British dude, he said, the movie not only made was nonsensical, shot poorly, and, you know, the colors were off, but the sound was garbled. One couldn't even understand the dialogue. So my dad called him up and said, listen, I'm not asking you to change your review, but I challenge you to come see this film in the hood. Come see it up in Harlem with me. And the guy said, well, I'll take that challenge, bro. So he went up there, and he didn't even speak Ebonics, that's all. So suddenly he's in the movie theater, and for the first time, he's seeing it with all black folks, and they're going crazy, understanding every word, seeing it show after show. But you have to understand, and this is why it was so important, was that if you're a member of the dominant culture, and every SAT is for you, and every driver's test is for you, and everything is set up for you, it's very hard for you to conceive of anyone else getting other treatment, right? But if you Mexican, or you African-American, or Native American, you can understand, you sit right away and go, that's how we do. You know what I mean? So he understood that, and he invited them. The coolest thing wasn't just his marketing, but was that he understood it's not your color, it's where your heart is. And I looked at my dad, and his best friends were all flavors. The people that supported him were all flavors. He never let that struggle make him bitter. That's cool, because if it makes you bitter, if it makes you hate, it can poison your art. It can poison your business.
Well, something else I wanted to note, you know, talking about black exploitation in the 70s and so forth, that there is a new group of independence.
That's right. Yeah.
That is working. Mm-hmm. And can you tell us about some of these?
Oh, sure. Well, one group is known as the LA Rebellion. There's a member of that group, Barbara McCullough, sitting right here. Amazing group of artists who studied at UCLA between the late 60s and the early 1980s, who includes Barbara, Julie Dash, Charles Burnett, Haile Garima, Alile Sharon Larkin. And they were, in many ways, responding to the Blaxploitation movement in the way that I was talking about how independent Black filmmakers during the race movie era were responding to Hollywood, in the sense that they really wanted to figure out ways to use the stylistic possibilities of cinema to speak directly to Black audiences, to not make films that were translating African-American life and problems, but instead reflecting them and really delving into the resources of the community. And so you were talking about the difficulty of reaching audiences. These are people who were making films initially that could make it into a big theatrical release. For some of them, that was okay, though, actually. They wanted to have their films shown on a smaller, more community-based scale. I'm thinking about a film like Larry Clark's Passing Through, which is a remarkable film about jazz musicians. He wanted that film passed hand to hand, as he puts it, so that there would always be a really sort of meaningful desire on the part of the audience to see it. He didn't want it circulating in the same kind of commercial setting. So there are lots of ways that Black filmmakers have used the kind of like independent designation to experiment formally with the film styles they're using, to experiment with the business practices, to think about different ways of reaching Black audiences. And some of the people in the LA Rebellion group certainly felt that the commercial film industry was so limiting in the way that it would shape the way you would approach a film. So they were just playing around with all these things that you might see as marginal or kind of like sub-dominant, but deliberately so. And you see a proliferation of those kinds of experiences.
One thing, going back with Spencer Williams, yeah. Blood of Jesus and so were his films shown at Black churches?
They were, yes.
So we were talking about reaching an audience.
That's
because
right.
They were, you might call them faith-based movies and stuff. But I thought that was great. And there were also films that were shown at Black schools.
Yes.
For kids, exactly. That wherever you can reach an audience.
That's right.
You know, if you don't have them in a big theater, whatever, but there's an audience there, and there's an audience with hunger.
That's right.
To see something that speaks to them in different terms. So that as well, when you're talking about the LA Rebellion and the film makers. Are you going to do a set of films on this?
There is a collection of the UCLA Film and Television Archive that has that material.
Yeah.
But it's probably worth saying, because Babu was acknowledged earlier, but the Pan-African Film Festival and the Black Film Festivals have also been an incredibly important network for celebrating and showcasing the work of Black independent filmmakers who wouldn't be able to reach audiences without them.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have something interesting that develops, again, going back to these images, these mainstream images, by the 80s and into the 90s. We have these African-American stars within Hollywood who get to a different point than their predecessors do, someone like a Denzel Washington. And some of them forming their own production companies, still working in a way within the industry, but trying. I'm thinking of Denzel now with Fences, the August Wilson play that he brings to the screen. And quite frankly, the way it was done, I think that at that point he was the only one who could have done it. And it was a labor of love. And you see him in it, you see Viola Davis. And so there are these people who attain a certain kind of level of stardom that have some kind of clout or influence and try to use it. And we then get into another thing where does the independent, the truly independent movement go? Where does it go?
That's such a good question.
Mario?
Yeah.
Because you have a film coming out called Armed.
Correct.
And is that a truly independent film?
Truly. You get, part of my financing is right over there.
Barbara?
So basically what I sort of developed was, I said, okay, what I'm going to try to do is do the couple for them and then the one for me. You know, so that's the way we did Badass was, you know, I went out and made some money doing... It was interesting. My dad did Sweetback in 71. I get to do New Jack City in 1991. I made some money with that, then did Heartbreak Ridge and Posse and other movies. But I went off, and then I would put together my own thing. I'm not afraid of that, because I'm not a materialistic cat. I grew up seeing this guy. So none of us in my family are slaves to materialism. So once you have enough clothes to wear in a house, you can send folks to school. You just make the movies you want to make. And my dad always said, you know, it's like being a poor man cooking. Cook something you like to eat because you might be the only one eating. You might have to eat it for a while. So periodically I'll go off and say, what do I want to do? And recently I did a film I talked to my dad about it called Arm. And they have that saying, nothing stops a good guy with a gun like a bad guy with a gun. We know that's not actually true. And I play a guy with many guns who's on the no-fly list. Obviously, we didn't take NRA money. And it's based on real stories. But it's going to come out in theaters. We're getting, you know, but it's a fight, man, because you understand it as a filmmaker, even with, you know, the medium clout I have, I still have to make it, grow it, bring it to the table. And then it's not enough to have the kid. You got to get it through college. So I've got to distribute it and go to marketing. And luckily, I, you know, have folks in it who can do that. But the struggle to make a truly independent film like that, where it's absolutely independent financing and get it distributed, is still a big climb. Yeah. Now, I'll get an offer to direct something else. You know, for
well, you've also directed, didn't you, with the New Roots?
Sure.
Yeah.
So I'll get offers to do other things, and I'll bring my vision to it, and I care about those.
Well, with something like, and I didn't want to get into television today, but with something like that, mm-hmm. Do you feel you can be true to your vision?
I wouldn't do it. That's the first thing.
I mean, did you ever have any interference?
I had no. I told him straight up. I said, "Don't do nothing. You got a Van Peebles now. Are you okay with that?" You have to be clear. And he said, "I am welcoming." And I have to say, I went through it, and I put stuff in that script that was, man, when you see that second episode of Roots, I'm really proud of that history. Yeah. It, you know, we did stuff, because it's about a guy who thinks he's going to have a son, and so he has a badass daughter.
Yeah.
And he's got to say, this is what I got, and I'm going to train her to be free, and I'm going to train her to know who she is, and teach her everything I can, and passes it on, and I have a couple badass daughters, man. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's lovely. I want to show that. So they let me do it, but I went in there with that caveat. And by then, my brand was strong enough that they don't call me up unless they want that brand, because mm-hmm. that's not gonna, you know, that just mm-hmm. I'm not gonna do it, you know. But I think, look, here's the thing. We know that when apartheid fell, the two favorite shows they were watching. From Miami Vice with the white leading man and the black leading man, and the Cosby Show, and apartheid falls. And we know that 20 years after Melvin does Sweetback, you have Singleton and Spike and the Hudlins and me all thinking we could be filmmakers, because it takes that 20 years of kids saying, I want to be the success mm-hmm. I see, to grow up. And that those same kids that would look at those shows would later grow up and say, I can conceive of the Huxtables in the White House as the Obamas.
Yes.
So medium is so important, because yeah. it puts, before you have it in the White House, you're going to see it on television. You will see Morgan. So us representing across the board is so important in a positive way.
Well, you know, you mentioned Spike, and I'm glad you did.
Yeah.
I don't know how I didn't get to mention him. But,
he's a hell of a marketer as well.
Yes.
Right?
And that's the other guy.
Yes, he's a hell of a
marketer. He's very much like, in a sense, like carrying on your tradition with Michelle, your father.
Absolutely.
And also Spike, I mean, the great thing about him and Warrington Hudlin and so forth, that acknowledging the past. I mean, what you were saying about Herb Jeffries and the Black Westerns.
Sure.
To acknowledge that and to show it. I'll tell you, there's a key moment in Black Panther that I think Ryan Coogler, black filmmaker, I think only a black filmmaker in a way could have done it. It's just one of these moments where he brings on Angela Bassett. And he no doubt grew up seeing her, and seeing her as royalty. And she plays a royal figure in Black Panther. And the way he shoots her, she's there, and she radiates this strength and composure.
Right.
And he's there to film it. And I don't know if a white filmmaker would have done it the way he did. It reminds me when Steven Spielberg did a film in which he brought in Audrey Hepburn. And at that point, Hepburn's career, you know, she wasn't acting as much, but she was royalty for him. And so one of the great things about Black Panther was that moment when he brings Angela in. And I said, well, she's not going to have much to do in this film. And then she comes back and does all of these miraculous things, which leads me now to, I just want a general, your general feeling about, and we have to do it quickly because we want to get into something else. Mario said to me when I told him what I wanted to cover, he sort of
said, an hour.
I said, good luck. He said to me, it's going to be 4 hours long. So, the thing is, I'm just curious, Gil, in general, how do you feel about Hollywood's Black images today? I'm not talking about Black filmmakers even working within the Hollywood system. I mean, as filmmakers, mm-hmm. How do you feel about those images?
You mean the images coming out of Hollywood?
Yes.
Today? You know, they certainly, it's an improvement.
Yeah.
You know, you definitely see growth. You definitely see a new level of openness to different types of stories. Otherwise, you would have never seen a movie like Moonlight get made, certainly not win the Oscar. So things are getting better, but there's still a long way to go. Mm-hmm. You know, with Ryan, the work that Ryan Coogler's doing and Ava DuVernay and...
Well, I don't want it so much, excuse me, I'm thinking about, because I want to talk about them, but films not by African-American filmmakers, but just sort of films in general, what we see in Hollywood films of African-Americans.
Well, I definitely think that you see an expansion of the identity, and I think that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Sorry. Jump in real quick because something just happened. One of my sons, Mandela, just got an offer to do a lead in the film. Right, he's an actor and doing his thing. But what's interesting is the film was colorblind. It's a horror movie, and the Negro lives to the end. Mm. Van Peebles, right? He said, yes. He said, he lives to the end. So, you know, that's kind of unusual. And I said, well, cool white dude. He just said, I'd like to cast colorblind. And, you know, we saw Get Out, and we saw this, and I'm going to have the brother live to the end. Said, let's look at that. He has a wife, the whole thing. Man. So I was like, now, and this was not, I didn't do the catering, I didn't write it, I had nothing to do with it. I don't know if it's going to be good or bad, but that's an interesting thing to see that offer come in. That is not an offer that I would have gotten back in the day. Mm-hmm. And so I've seen changes. Even television commercials now, you see mixed couples up to it.
Well, the commercials are funny because...
Son of Cheerios!
But you know, there was about 3 years ago, they had a commercial with an interracial couple. And they did get...
Oh, I know, but now it's all over.
Now
it's all over, baby.
You will see. You see all sorts of things. That's true. But with that and thinking about... sort of current images in film in general, not by Black filmmakers. When we do get to Black filmmakers today, and you have Ryan Coogler, and you have Ava DuVernay, and you have Jordan Peele, who gives us Get Out, who takes a genre and just twists it and reconfigures it and brings race into it, and it's suddenly new and so exciting. By the way, Jordan Peele is the first African-American to win an Oscar for an original screenplay. We've had two people before, Jeffrey Fletcher, who did Precious, and John Ridley, who did 12 Years a Slave, who won Oscars for Best Adapted Screenplay. And that's a triumph there.
Oh, yeah.
But Jordan's is different. But how do you feel about some of these films, and Lee Daniels, who's more now on television, you've directed in part, correct?
Yep.
What do you think of just generally their work and this whole question of independent filmmakers? And you said you had no problems when you did Roots on TV, the new Roots.
Well, I didn't, but I made my stance clear.
Yeah, well, you're going to be.
And that was 12 million an episode, so it wasn't cheap.
Mm-hmm. Right now, with Armed, I did it for a low budget number. So I think, go back to the thing with the Jordan Peele incident. He does something beautiful. I talked to Jordan about this. That brother hands you a bottle of Merlot, and it's smooth, and you love it, and you're halfway drinking it down before you realize it's a political Molotov cocktail. And then, like, blew up in your face! You know what I mean? So he just had me something, but boom! You know what I mean? But you're so enjoying what it is. But he did it for a number. So that kind of statement made, you know, at that number is dope. Now, the same day we talked earlier about Badass, there's an interesting article in the LA Times. The same day that Badass came out, my script, my movie about my dad, Soul Plane came out. Now, so the Times right, the Times right, his brother writes a really genius article. He says, okay, so here you have Soul Plane made by a studio at $16 million mm-hmm. that says the idea of folks of color running an airline is laughable.
Oh, right.
Right? It's a joke. And here you have Badass, made by an independent filmmaker, that says the fact that a black man working with all kind of folks can make a hit film is possible. So one is a message of disempowerment, and one is a message of empowerment. It goes back to what I said about that revolutionary cape. If you're talking about people uniting across color lines, and uniting across my box, your box, gay box, straight box, white box, black box, anytime you unite, we are powerful together.
Yeah.
And that's what I saw Daddy do. It wasn't just for black folks, it was for all of us. That was the dope stuff. So you're saying that Melvin can win and unite over all of us? That's not a movie that you'll get funded. You say black folks running an airline is a joke? That's something you can put a couple rappers in, you'll get funded. You want to do some hip hop that says something? Now Kendrick Lamar is starting to do that, right? Mm-hmm. But you have, for every one of those, you're going to get 12 of these other cats with gold teeth who are not representing us that way. So I think it's the same thing in cinema.
Well, I just want to know this, though. From each of you, with some of these films that have come out, now Moonlight was an independent film, and he didn't get it made right away. And Hollywood gives him their greatest accolade, which is quite interesting. But do you think, and we want to keep in mind this thing about an independent filmmaker, what do you think of these films like Black Panther? And what do you think of, we've already talked about Get Out, how do you feel about these films? Do these artists still, are they able to hold on to their integrity? And are these distinct visions coming out of the films? Gil?
Well, the jury is still out what's going to happen, how well this town will treat Ryan. One would hope that he receives an opportunity that the success of this project would mean, you know, that the door would be wide open, the checkbook would be open, that he would be given the same type of freedom as if he were a white, you know, director. But history tells us something different. So there's really no way of knowing. You know, all we can really do is hope. You know, obviously now, given technology, given other avenues of distribution, Ryan has other options to deliver his work and have his work seen. So it's a little bit different today, because technology has sort of opened the door of opportunity that previous generations, you know, didn't have available to them.
Mm-hmm. Jack?
You know, I think that the current moment illustrates just how tricky the question of race, racial identity, racial politics continues to be. Black Panther was a phenomenal movie-going experience. White people marginalized in the film, in the theater I went to, the white people were pretty quiet because the black folks were really dominating. That must be an unusual experience for white people. Mm-hmm. And so I think one of the really important points that Mario made when he was talking about this way in which the media helps to cultivate a different sense of yourself and possibilities over time, I think white audiences, some of them are becoming more open to seeing stories in which they are not at the center. Selma is a much different kind of movie than Mississippi Burning, for example. Mm-hmm. And there are ways in which I think contemporary black filmmakers are able to do the kinds of things that earlier independents were doing, humanizing black characters and having just slightly more flexible to call a white person a colonizer.
Yeah, exactly.
Black Panther.
Exactly.
It's radical.
We only have one more question. So Mario.
I'm going to add something. See, man, this is such rich stuff. I hate
this
to write.
Started.
Is this good? Don't get me started. but it's such an interesting thing. So thank you for doing this, man, and asking these questions.
So we're
right in the middle of history. That thing that made you live an interesting time today. You live an interesting time. You've got Colonel Marmalade in the White House. We live an interesting time. So here's the thing. It's funny that you asked me. Someone said to me, look online. There's this whole debate about your movie Panther. And I look online. Sure enough, there's one brother who does this video. And he says, we got folks putting on dashikis and going to see a movie by Stan Lee. They didn't care about black folks. He did this movie called Black Panther. What we should have done that was with the original movie on the Panther that the Van Peebles did.
Mm.
But I wanted to be very careful. I didn't respond to that because here's the thing. You got to know who you're trying to reach. You can make a beautiful movie called Aquila and the Bee, and 12 people will see it. Mm-hmm. But if you get that whole audience to see that little cool-ass girl in Black Panther who's the science geek, that'll mean more to all the young sisters who see that man. That is so important. I had a dinner at my house 15 years ago, because I was on the cover of the New York Times with me, Spike, the Hudlins, Maddie Rich, John Singleton, and I said, look, we're getting together when they decide to take our picture and decide that we're important. There's something wrong with that. We're waiting for them to decide it's time that we should acknowledge them. Dr. King says, why are you waiting for your enemy to give you a reward? If you play football and they're playing football and they give you an award, something's wrong. You need to look at that. So I went around.
That's how we started Africa.
Right? So I went around and got everybody's number. We had dinner at my crib. So all of them came. Singleton, Matty Rich, I mean, everybody came. And we started talking about black film and how we love Dennis Rodman. Why Dennis Rodman? Because we had so many brothers playing basketball. We could have a Dennis Rodman who could be weird and marry himself. We're not at that point. We're cool. He could dry his hair, paint, date Madonna, marry himself. We don't care because we got Michael Jordan. We got Magic Johnson. Until in cinema, we are no longer ambassadors to self.
Right.
We are not free. We're not free to fail. We're not free to try new stuff. If Woody Allen was the only white filmmaker, they'd all be picking on him. But why are you making us look weird? Because he's just Woody Allen. That's just a Woody Allen flick. I don't mind if Brother Tyler Perry wants to put on a dress. As long as we have representation across the board,
well,
we should have our government.
Good point with Tyler Perry. He was here yesterday.
We should have our dumb and dumber. We should have Brother Spike's vision. Mm-hmm. We should have Sister Ava's vision. Mm-hmm. The thing is, not having that representation, the lack of diversity, forces us to turn on each other and say, your film didn't represent the pregnant Puerto Rican problem. And dude, your film wasn't realistic because I know a brother who was in the Panthers and he wears beret this way. No. We should be free as artists and people to make mistakes, to do great, and just like we're on the ball court. No one thinks if LeBron don't make it, that it's the end of black basketball.
Mario. On that note, we have to end. I want to thank all three of these for the great insights and knowledge. And with that, good afternoon.
Thank you.